Okay, my name is Luke Somerville. This is our property. Me and my wife, Donna, own this and all that over there. So I have a big area where we've decided, instead of just letting it grow wild and weed whacking it, we've planted all kinds of flowers and plants. And here we have roses and daylilies and ground cover. So then, over the last couple of years, I, like a lot of people, have been reading about the decline of the honeybee. And I thought, wow, we have all the flowers and we have the room. Why don't we try and save them in our own little way and get a hive? So this year, we installed our first hive.
Okay, how did the bees come to you?
Okay, we order the bees maybe in January, February. I use a place called West Side Bee Boys. They're at home in Roosevelt. Great guys. They can help you out with any. They answer all my questions. Be brand new at it. Everything seems new.
Yeah, I'm glad I'm sorry. Did you know anybody who did this before?
Not really.
Okay.
There's some people in the neighborhood who have hives.
Okay.
You know, there's some, like at 99th and Campbell, there's a couple hives in somebody's backyard.
All right.
Greg with Bavard Brewing on 100th, right across from town. He sells mead. Mead is the oldest form of alcohol, even older than champagne, they say, but it's wine made from honey. And now he's opening, so we're on the west end of the Dan Ryan Woods. He's opening a meadery on the east end of Dan Ryan Woods at 91st Street.
Okay.
So I decided to get into this to save the bees, and because I had a great habitat for it. So in January, February, you order your bees. So I ordered, like I said, for the West Side Bee Boys, and they say they'll come in late April. They don't send that. They bring them in on a semi from California, and they don't even start sending the semi until they see that there's going to be a week of decent weather. So my bees came in the weekend before April 25th, and I went and picked them up Monday morning, April 25th. So this is how they give them to you. They say this is a 3-pound box of bees in here, and you can see there's a couple deceased bees still in there. In here is like a coffee can full of sugar water, and that's what they eat to sustain themselves the whole ride from California.
So 3 pounds, how many, you know, what approximately how many bees is that? Any idea?
3 pounds. I don't know.
Okay.
A couple thousand maybe.
Okay.
Maybe not.
So it's packed?
1,000 maybe. There's room for them to fly around. I'd say it's half full.
Okay.
And bees don't mind climbing on each other. This is a queen cage. It's solid on four sides. Fifth side is a screen, and the sixth side is a hole. The queen is in there. They take care of her through the screen, dirt from California all the way back here. And they put a plug, a cork, in that hole right there. When you get your bees, okay, they are bees from a hive, a random hive, and a queen where they make their own queen, okay? You see this piece of metal there? So they hang the queen here. Oh, the metal broke. So the queen hangs in there.
Can you visually distinguish the difference between the queen and the other bees?
The queen is bigger and marked. It has marking on her.
Okay.
She has a mark from them. They did it.
You know,
the people who sell it.
Okay.
A little Sharpie mark on her.
Okay.
But anyway, so then you have your queen. Now you dump all your bees in to your hive, and you pull the cork out and put a piece of candy in there or a marshmallow. And then you hang the bee, the queen, in your cage, or in your hive, in the cage, with them facing the screen and the candy facing down. Then over the next day or so, the worker bees get to know the queen, they get familiar with her, and they eat their way through it. So if they eat their way through the marshmallow and then let her out, and then that's their queen, and they've gotten used to her over a couple days. They say that if you let the queen out right away and just threw her in there, they wouldn't know that's her queen, their queen, and there's a good chance they would just kill her. So, you know, because they may think that their old queen from their old hive is in there somewhere and they don't know it. So when you get them, you have to get yourself a spray bottle from Ace Hardware, and you spray through the screen, you spray sugar water, and once that gets on them, they start eating it, they become lethargic, and you can dump them in, no problem. So I've been opening the hive, I've opened it 4 or 5 times now, plus installing the bees, and I have not been stung once yet. There's the beehive. First year of having a bee, having bees, having a hive. I installed this hive on April 25th, I believe it was a Monday. It's been generally just cold since then. As you can see, the bees are flying all over the place. We are not going into the hive per se today. We are just going to check and see if they have any food left. I only have about 6 ounces of food, which is just sugar water.
Okay, so there's sugar water in that bottle there?
Yeah. So we'll see if they have any. And they do not. So you have to decide if there are enough flowers around. And there aren't in the neighborhood, really. But they have plenty in Dan Ryan Woods.
Here, can I do to peek in there?
Yeah. I just have those bricks in there to hold this up.
Okay, so that's the inside.
Well, the inside of the hive is through that hole right there.
Okay, we're not going to go in there.
No. Not unless you want to. But I'd have to get suited up for that. And then... Now the bottle's empty. You don't want to leave exposed sugar water just sitting around because you might attract other bees. From Jen and Paul's hive, we don't want them attacking each other, that's for sure. But they installed their bees last Saturday. So this is a little tricky here. This works on the suction. So it's gonna dribble at first and then it stops. They may like it, they may not. So now, see, it's not dripping at all. So we'll set that down. We might need to make up another batch of sugar water later. We put the top outer cover back on. And this is our anti-raccoon theft. They say all you need to keep a raccoon out is a heavy brick on top.
So raccoons are drawn to?
Absolutely. Raccoon would have this top off and in there eating the honey. They would destroy the hive.
And they'd have no fear of the bees?
None. And the worst thing for a hive is bears. But we don't have bears around here. So bears, the only thing you can do is an electric fence. So the this hive I installed April 25th, as I said, it has Italian bees. They might have been in America for 200 years now, but I don't know. But they've now been bred to be varroa mite sensitive. Varroa mites are a big threat to bees because they attach to larvae. They're very tiny. Think about bee larvae. I mean, it's like a piece of rice. But now you have a mite that attaches to it as the larvae is trying to grow, and it ruins the larvae. The bee is never going to develop, and it feeds the mite, and then they reproduce in the hive, and they kill a hive. Or you're going to have to treat them with chemicals, which we don't want any chemicals involved if we can help it. There's no chemicals on any of our flowers. We pull all these weeds by hand. Anyway, this varroa mite now has been genetically engineered so that the worker bees will know, they will sense that there's a varroa mite on the larvae. They will go in, grab the varroa mite and the larvae out of the honeycomb and bring it and throw it out of the hive. They will know it that it's garbage. So we'll see if it works.
How does a beekeeper like yourself contribute to the health of the bees and what are nutritional needs of a bee?
Okay, so in the beginning, in the spring and in the fall, you want to make sure that they have enough food. The fall they're making honey. So if you can see that they have enough honey in the hive to make it through the winter, then you can just leave it. After a year or so, you'll be able to take honey and you'll have honey for yourself. They say a hive that is established. Mine is just starting to build all the honeycomb starting April 25th. So this hive won't be established until August, September. It'll make some honey, but they're gonna need most of that honey to survive all winter. So What I can do now is I put sugar water in there. So they're eating, still eating sugar water while we're waiting for more spring blooms to come out. I have seen some of the bees flying in with pollen on them. So they're finding some. What I can do to make them safe is make sure they've got a water source, which is I have a little sprinkler on, very lightly sprinkling water into a top of a 5-gallon bucket. So it's very shallow water. We have some corks and some rocks in there for them to fly onto so they don't fall in the water and drown. And the water source is the biggest thing. They will find the closest one. They've already found this one. I've seen the bees in there. That keeps them from going into people's pools or going into a puddle in the alley and maybe getting run over. You know, you just don't want to lose bees. So that's one way you keep them fed and safe. Make sure nothing's going to bother them over here. We have the rock on top to keep the raccoons out. But for the most part, we should be fine here.
Okay.
Towards the end of this summer, fall, you want to make sure no mice crawl up in there. They'll eat it and they'll make your home in there and, you know, trying to live there all winter, and that will ruin the hive.
Okay, Luke, can you please tell us the different types of bees and their roles in the bee world?
Okay, there are three overarching types of bees. There's the queen, the workers, they are both female, and then there's the drones, which are the males. The bee world is a women's world, make no mistake about it. Men are an afterthought and they have one purpose. So, the origin of the hive, you have a queen, you have to have a queen to lay the eggs. The queen will lay eggs in the bottom hive box. She'll lay them in, you know, the workers will build out all the cells. She'll lay eggs. If she lays an unfertilized egg, which she will do from time to time, down near the bottom or to the side, that's where the drones come from. And a fertilized egg will always be a worker. If the hive decides that queen isn't producing enough, or if the hive has gotten so crowded that they think they need to split, the hive will start, the workers will start feeding one of the worker bee cells a thing called royal jelly. And that royal jelly will make that larvae become a queen. How they do that, I'm not really sure. It's one of the miracles of science. But anyway, for the most part, if you have a healthy queen laying healthy eggs, that's all she does, and they're all fine. The worker bees are then, so you have one queen, and all the worker bees take care of the queen. Then your worker bees get broken into, and I'm not sure exactly the weeks, but for the first week, they keep the hive clean, they feed the larvae, they, you know, throw out, if a bee dies, they get the bee out of the hive. They clean it themselves, take everything out that they want to take out. And then I think after 10 days, then it might become a guard bee at the entrance to make sure only bees that belong in that hive get in. And then after that, they become a foraging bee. And the drones, now we'll go back, where if you have a new queen, that queen needs to have fertilized eggs. So they do a mating flight. It's about 1,500 feet in the air. You can see, like, it'll be a dark, you know, 10-foot circle in the sky, 1,500 feet up, where you'll just see this dark, and it's a bunch of drones flying around, and the queen flies in and mates with a bunch of drones. Part of the negative thing of being a drone is once you mate, just like a stinger, the male part stays in the queen. He pulls away, he loses the bottom half of his body, and if he doesn't get eaten by a bird on his fall, he's dead before he hits the ground, and he's done. The queen mates with multiple drones, comes back, and never leaves the hive again. A good queen, they say, will last 3 years. So a lot of people believe you replace the queen after 2 summers. So you can buy one, you can make your own, you can let them make your own, you can do a number of ways. Back to the drones. Now, the drone is in there, in the hive. There's not much use for them. They want to make sure that they're mating. They can go up and mate with other queens. But then you get to the fall, and bees are going to stay in their hive, basically, in Chicago, winter. And they have stored enough honey to feed them throughout the winter. But, of course, there's no use for a drone, so why would you want the drone in there eating the food? So in the fall, the worker bees kick all the drones out. Wow. That's it. You are, as the one class I took, the teacher said, somebody raised their hand and said, what happens to those drones? And he said, bird food. They're dead. They're gone. They kick them all out. So it's not the, it's definitely not a man's world, though. Then they're hunkered down for the winter. And we'll go through the wintering. A lot of people wonder, how do they survive? The queen is in the center, and they take turns rotating around the queen. There'll be a big cluster. And bees, once they're warmed up, they'll come to the outside. Other bees will go in, warm up, and they just keep rotating. Queen stays in the middle. The temperature around the queen in a Chicago winter, it's 20 below outside. The temperature at the queen is 90 degrees all winter long. So that the bees make their own heat by flapping their wings and moving around. And that's why they need the honey, to have that energy. But they basically don't do anything but keep it warm. All right. Every box that I bought, mediums, they call them. So they're, you know, about this high, a little higher. And they hold 10 frames. I bought 10. You can buy short frames, which the brown hive is a short frame. Jen and Paul's hive. Mine is medium frame, so they're this high. Theirs is a little shorter. I bought a 10-frame hive, which means you put 10 of these frames per box. You can get an 8-frame hive if you want. So this is a plastocell frame, and the bees will build it out, okay? And then in the fall, if you're harvesting honey, you'll uncap all the honey cells, damaging them, and you'll get honey. Once we've got the bees sort of establishing themselves, they're building out on this plastocell, all right? They're building out their honeycomb. The queen's laying the eggs. You go in, I'll maybe go in tomorrow to look at them. You wait for a nice day like today, not too windy, definitely not rainy, and not cold. Three things the bees don't like: wind, rain, and cold. So during, now once they've been in there a month, whenever I want to open the hive, I use my smoker, okay? Smoker, you put paper in here and some kindling, get a flame going. I forget what they call this. Pumps fresh air in, and so once you get it, the kindling and the paper lit really well, you throw in some fairly like finger-sized sticks. And once they're started, you put the top on, close it up, and you let the fire burn out, but those sticks, once they were lit, they will smolder for quite a while, like an hour. And you use that cool smoke to smoke the bees. You just puff a little smoke at the entrance and wait a couple minutes. Puff a little smoke down in the hive when you open the top and wait again. And that calms the bees, but it also sends a message to the worker bees. Well, there's two trains of thought there. One train of thought, people believe that the smoke calms the bees, and they think that there might be a fire, but the smoke masks the panic pheromone that they will send out, so it doesn't tell everybody there's a problem. Some people believe that. Others believe you pump the smoke in, and they start gorging themselves on the honey because they think there's a fire coming, so they gorge themselves on the honey, so they're ready to take flight and abandon the hive. They take as much honey with them as they can. Well, while they're gorging themselves with honey, they're all of a sudden lethargic and moving very slow, waiting for the last minute of the fire to take off. Of course, the fire never comes. You're in there checking on them, making sure they're healthy, looking for a healthy queen. And when you lift up a frame to the sun, the sun will hit it like this, and you can look in there and see if there's larvae in the cells.
While we're on the topic, how far do bees, or how far do they typically travel in a day?
They can go up to 3 miles. So there are bees, messenger bees, that go and they scout and they find the flowers with the pollen. And those bees will come back and they'll go right outside the hive and they'll do like a figure eight dance while they're flying. And that dance is some kind of code telling the bees exactly how to get to those flowers. It's pretty wild. Yeah,
that is.
They tell them in advance where the flowers are, how far away, what kind of flowers they are, and then they can go to that. So as long as they have a water source, they'll use the closest water source. But then they will go to their closest, best source of pollen. So like we have a ton of daylilies around here. If they can find something else, they will pass the daylilies and go to something better.
Okay, so your ultimate goal is you hope to produce honey someday.
Right, so they say your first year you might get enough honey. Right now I have one box that the bees are filling out. Last time we checked, they had four frames that they had built out pretty well, and they were just starting the next two out on each side, and they had two completely blank on there. So any day now, I'm gonna add another box on top, put 10 more frames in, and they'll start building that up. So what we'll get in the fall is that bottom box will be full of larvae and bees and working. The second box, they'll come up and they'll start filling that with honey. Now, after this hive is established next year, I'll add another box and they'll start putting honey up in the third box. That generally is the honey you can take. They'll fill that second box and that's their honey for the winter. But anything they do, I've seen people with six boxes up and they pull four of those boxes down and uncap the frames and it just drips honey. They say a fully established hive that starts the spring with the honeycomb all built out and everything can produce 60 pounds of honey per hive.
Luke, thank you so much for your time and expertise in our beekeeper research. What advice, if somebody's thinking of getting into beekeeping, what advice do you have for them?
So I started hearing, as everybody else did, about the decline of the bees and thought, oh, I'd like to do that. First thing I did is I got a great book I liked, Beekeeping for Dummies. So that was a great source. I read it all the time. As I'm going through steps, I read about the next steps I'm going to take, and then I go out and do it, you know, just a refresher. I read another book, I can't even recall the name of it, but I took a couple classes. The Chicago Honey Co-op does a good class, and the West Side Bee Boys are doing classes constantly. The thing I like about the West Side Bee Boys is they're local, and they are a constant source of information. So I've gone, I bought everything I bought from them and the bees, and now I can call them, or I can go in there, and I can say, all right, this is what I need, or this is what's going on, what can I do? And they're familiar with everything I'm doing, and they know me personally, and you go in there and talk to them. It's sort of like I ride my bike a lot. I go to the Beverly Bike Shop, and they're my one-stop source for everything, and they get to know what you need. So these guys tell me what I'm doing. I'm getting another hive in a week to 10 days.
Will that be coming from California?
No, though this hive will be from the West Side Bee Boys, one of their hives that wintered in Chicago, and they've already split it, and they put it in, it's called a nuke. So it's one box. These are short boxes. Mine are called medium. These are short, I think they're called. They're gonna give it to me with five frames in a box, and I'm gonna take it and just start a new hive out in the field. We'll see which one works better. You can see where the sun is now. We don't know how much sun these hives are going to get through the winter. So we'll see. Maybe we'll come back and film again when we close up the hives or something.